Good morning, everyone, and happy Sabbath. So glad that you are here today. We are celebrating today Global Youth Day. I'll talk to you a little bit more about that during the sermon, but we're going to just get started off today by worshiping, by praising God, and we want to invite you to just join in with your whole heart. Think about what God's done in your life this last week. Think about what you'd like Him to do in your life, and know that He can do it. Know that He is big enough, He's strong enough, and I pray that you'd be able to enter into His rest today. We got to do that reminder that, yes, we do wear our masks in the church here, following the guidelines of the CDC to keep everybody healthy and hopefully get things back to normal here in our country as soon as possible. But let's all just come together now in unity around Jesus, the one who saves.
Of the scripture, because today's scripture reading actually goes really well with our first song, which is "To God Be the Glory." So please stand as I read Psalms 145, verse 3 and 4. It says, "Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, and His greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall praise your works to another, and shall declare your mighty acts." Amen. If we don't sing and shout out, it says, what will? The rocks would. And I don't want the rocks to outdo us this morning in praising our living God. Amen? So sing "To God Be the Glory" with us.
To God be the glory, great things He has done. So loved He the world that He gave us His Son, who yielded His life an atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear His voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear His voice. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. You may be seated. Our next song is an oldie but goodie, Jesus is the Answer. There are different ways. I grew up singing it a different way. Monica sang it a different way at camp. Rosen sang it a different way in the Philippines. So we're going to teach you the way we all came up with to sing it this morning, okay? So we'll go over it once, and feel free to join in if you're familiar with it. Let's try. Jesus is the Answer.
Jesus is the answer for the world today. Above him there's no other. Jesus is the way. Jesus is the answer for the world today. Above him there's no other. Jesus is the way. Let me hear. Jesus is the answer for the world today. Above him there's no other. Jesus is the way. Jesus is the answer for the world today. Above him there's no other. Jesus is the way.
And the verse goes like this.
If you have some questions in the corners of your mind and traces of discouragement, peace you cannot find, reflections of the old past, they seem to face you every day. There's one thing I know for sure, that Jesus is the way. All my days. I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Good morning, church. The water is extremely cold today, so I chose to do all my communication out here instead of in the tank. Yeah, I'm chicken. But it is a high Sabbath. In spite of cold water, I'm more than happy to get into the cold water to celebrate what the Lord has done and is doing. Jesus said, "My sheep hear my voice. My sheep hear my voice. They know it, and they follow me," right? There have been some people listening to Jesus' voice, and we're going to celebrate the experience that these people have had in listening to the voice of Jesus. Joseph Humbard, a member of a faithful family in our church, relatively new family. We just feel like we're at home with the Humbards already. They've been here a little while now. But Joseph, their son, has never been baptized. And it was just so exciting to know that no human being prompted him to make this decision. No human being prompted him to make this decision. Yes, he's had the good example of his brothers, and his family members, his parents, encouraging them to follow Jesus. But there was no direct link to the decision that Joseph made. He was just sitting in church one day. The Spirit of God convicted him, appealed to him. And he told his parents that he felt like he'd like to be baptized. And they brought him to me. And they said, "What do you think?" I said, "I think he's listening to the voice of God. I think we need to pay attention to this." And gave them a few materials to encourage him in his walk. We had a visit together, some prayer time together. But I'm just thrilled that Joseph has made this decision and he's listened to Jesus' voice. Now, the other person I want to introduce you to is Karsten Mortensen. Some of you may not be familiar with Karsten today, but you'll see him front and center when he's in the baptistry second today. He'll be the second baptism. And I just want to build up the ministry of our audiovisual team, our live stream team that is up there behind the scenes. You don't see them. But if you're ever watching live stream, the reason you have the quality that we have is because of this wonderful team pouring themselves into ministry, in the audiovisual ministry and live stream. And so Karsten is the first fruits. Yeah, you can clap for that. Karsten Mortensen is our first fruits, your first fruits, brothers and sisters up there, of your ministry of live stream, because the first contact that we had with Karsten, personal contact, that we even knew he was watching or listening, was my brother hosted a season of prayer by campfire in our backyard. Back in the cold winter months, the night before election, we were getting together to pray for our nation, that God would just supervise and bring unity where there has been a lot of division and a lot of heartache for some time now. And Karsten heard about that via live stream. I'd never met him before, so I came up and introduced myself. "How did you find out about this?" And he said, "I've been watching your live stream." And so he came to that event. It was a little while later, he started coming to church. And it wasn't long after that, after some sit down, Bible study together, reading material that he's seen, it didn't take me very long to realize he's one of those people that has been listening to the voice of Jesus for a long time. God has been leading him for many, many years. And so we're just thrilled that he's brought him to us to be part of our local church family as well. Now, before I go back in the baptistry, the last thing I want to do is leave an emptiness or misunderstanding on the part of any person in this room or watching on live stream as to why we do this. Now, let's face it, for centuries, it's been difficult for Christians to try and understand the difference between ceremonies and realities. Can you relate to that? What is it that's ceremonial? Now, let me be just really clear. There's only one gospel. Jesus, the Father and the Son, the Holy Spirit, in their work of redemption, there's only one plan to save people. It's by Jesus. There is no other plan, right? So there were some different practices in the Old Testament, but those were ceremonies, pointing to, seeking to illustrate the gospel. There were feast days, there were ceremonial sacrifices and washings and various other things. We don't practice those anymore, and for good reason. The Bible doesn't tell us to continue practicing those things. But the gospel never changes. There are ceremonies in the New Testament. Ceremonies are not the real thing. They help us understand and appreciate the real thing more deeply. Baptism and the Lord's Supper and foot washing are the ceremonies that God has given us to celebrate. So we're here to celebrate a ceremony, but a ceremony without meaning is fruitless and actually counterproductive to faith. So let me just identify with what the New Testament says about baptism very quickly so we appreciate what is going on here. We are going to see graphically illustrated in these waters right behind me the death, burial, and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. It's going to be acted out in front of us. so that we can appreciate what he's done for us and what he's done for these two people that are going to be baptized today. Amen? Now, there's two things to really appreciate this we must identify with, okay? Is that Jesus, our substitute, in fact, died in our place for our sins. The guilt and punishment that we should bear have fallen on him, and he buried it. He rose victorious over sin and death, and now Jesus has our humanity in heaven as a pledge of where he's going to take us someday. He's our man in heaven, amen? But there's another layer to this lesson that we must appreciate to really appreciate the ceremony. And that is, the Bible says, when he died, you died with him. Paul says, I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. We are to identify with his death in such a way that we say, my old life is dead with him, I'm dead to sin. And secondly, we identify with his resurrected life that says, in Jesus, I have victory over the sins that would control my life if not for him. Amen? We are celebrating all of that in this simple ceremony of baptism today, and may we live as if we believe the promise that's given in this ceremony. Amen?
Meet you.
Right, Joseph? Because you love Jesus Christ, you've surrendered yourself to him as your personal Lord and Savior, and you've received him. I now baptize you in the name of the Father and of his Son, Jesus Christ, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. It is cold. I'm sure that was shocking. Karsten, it's been a joy to watch your journey with Jesus. Because you love him and have received him as your personal Lord and Savior, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, of his Son, Jesus Christ, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
It's on. Can you hear? Yeah, you can. Baptism is the most wonderful thing to see, and even better when you participate in it. Without what I'm going to talk about today, which is a mustard seed, and a mustard seed is one of the smallest seeds in the world, and it's a little bitty dot there that's right in the center of the silver. And did you know that a mustard seed produces the biggest bush in the world? It can grow 83 feet wide and 30 feet wide and 30 feet tall. That's as big as almost this whole podium up here. That's a big bush. And it all starts with a little seed. And that's exactly what God does for us. He puts a little tiny seed on the inside of us. It's very private. It's a gift from him. And when you all of a sudden, you begin to realize Your parents have been talking to you about our Savior and Lord Jesus and His Father, our Heavenly Father. And even better is the Holy Spirit. And that little seed has to be fed, just like the mustard seed has to be fed with soil and water. And your parents provide the soil by teaching you and reading the scriptures with you. And that little seed on the inside, all of a sudden you're aware, what is that? Who is that? What is it that I'm feeling in there? And as they read the scriptures to you, and as you are watered by the Holy Spirit, you're going to hit a point where that little seed that they planted is going to want to bust out. And you're going to want to say, Mom, Dad, I believe, I know who Jesus is. He's inside of me. And it all started with that little mustard seed of faith. We all are given that seed of faith. And with the faith of a seed, you can move mountains. So when you become an adult, you're going to be strong in the Lord, and you're going to be able to say, I can move that mountain by faith. Boys and girls, enjoy your mustard seed and grow with it. Thank you.
Thank you. hung up here. Good morning. I'll get together here. Happy Sabbath. Imagine if you were going to put your offering in something, and it was visible for people to do that. You had two pennies, and you watched everyone around you putting in $100 bills. That would be a little bit embarrassing, wouldn't it? You know what I'm talking about. The story of the widow who put in the two mites, and she was very shy. She wanted to do that in such a way that no one could see her, where the other people around her were making a big deal of the amount of money they were putting in. And yet, whose offering was accepted more? You know, we all know that story. Hers was. Jesus commended her. "Of a truth, I say unto you that this poor widow hath cast in more than they all." Luke 21:3. And how can that be? The rich gave large coins, but she gave her heart as part of her offering. A Christian writer commented on this passage, "A heart of love and genuine faith in a worthy object is more acceptable to God than the most costly gift. The poor widow gave her living to do the little that she had. It was this unselfish spirit and unwavering faith that won the commendation of Jesus." We may think that the size of our offering makes a big difference and makes a difference in the value to God, but no, it's the size of our heart that really determines the value. Now, does this mean we should just give a little bit? No, it really doesn't. We should sacrifice. You know, God asks for sacrifice. Hear the words of Jesus. "For all those who have of their abundance cast unto the offerings of God, but she of her penury hath cast in all the living that she had." Luke 21:4. The widow sacrificed with her heart, and as the result, God blessed her gift. Our offering today is for local church budget. And I think it, you know, the church budget goes for things around the church, our ministries and various things like that. So I invite you to search your heart and decide how much you can give for that. Give out of your heart, and offering will, you can put that in the box at the door or give online. You have those options. And we've already heard the scripture, but I'm going to read it again. Psalm 145, verses 3 and 4. "Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall praise your works to another, and shall declare your mighty acts." I have a feeling that word generation might come into play a little bit here. You know, we are going to now pray, and I'm going to kneel, and I'm going to invite those of you who can to do the same. What I would like to do first, though, is just tell you a couple of the needs. That's kind of my practice when I'm doing this. We have a couple of families who've recently suffered loss. Dave, happy to see you here today, and sorry about the loss of your mother recently. And for those of you who've been longtime members, Pat Redderer passed away this last week, and there will be a memorial here tomorrow morning here at Chapel Oaks for her. So I'm going to pray for both those families. And then the other person that I want to mention is our dear sister, Becky. Becky Bartz, we have word from Dennis today. She is out of ICU, a little bit of improvement today, But Dennis is asking for each and every one of you to pray for a miracle for Becky. So shall we kneel at this time? Our Father, Lord, we just are so thankful to come before you, Lord. Come before you on this beautiful Sabbath day that you have given us. Lord, we thank you so much for the many, many blessings you give us. Father, I just imagine the angels are rejoicing right now over the decisions of Joseph and Karsten to follow you into the waters of baptism. Cold though they were, Father, we just thank you so much for their decisions. Father, I pray that you will send your holy angels to put a hedge around them, Lord, to protect them from everything that Satan will do to try to discourage them. Lord, I just pray that you will inspire us as their church family to be a support to them, to help and be a positive influence in any way that we can. Lord, I just ask that you will be with the youth today on this day that they are going to be doing so much. And this is not just here in our church, not just in Kansas City, but very, very widespread. Lord, I just pray that you will be with them and bless their efforts. Father, I ask that you will be with those who are hurting. In whatever way they might be hurting, Lord, whether it is spiritually, emotionally, because of financial problems, and physically, Lord. And Father, I just want to especially lift up our dear sister Becky to you. Lord, you know about her situation. Lord, you know that she has had complications following a surgery. And Father, I just ask that you will touch her with your healing hand. You are the great physician. Father, we just ask so much, if it be your will, that Becky be returned to health. Father, you will be glorified. You will be glorified, and people will see your mighty healing power. Father, we just ask for that. And now, Lord, be with us throughout the remainder of this service. Bless us, bless Pastor Nick, and Lord, may his words be yours. In your holy name I pray. Amen.
Joseph, if you could come join me up front now. Are you still here? Yes. All right. Karsten, come right on over, too. Now, believe it or not, something very special happens when you make this decision for baptism. You actually become an official part of this local church body. You're members of the body of Christ, which is worldwide, but you're also official members of this local body. Because of COVID, everyone is not here, so you will be voted in via email, but the email has been sent out already, so I want to encourage you today. If you haven't seen it yet, you will receive it today. The email is coming, so be sure to cast your vote for these two new members of our church family here. We're so grateful for your decision. And you know, there's a reason that God puts us together in church families, actually more than one reason. You need us. As faulty and broken as we are, you need us. And we need you. There are things about you that God has created unique and special that will help us in our spiritual journey. And there are things about us, believe it or not, that are going to help you in your spiritual journey. We want to do that effectively. Do I have your commitment, friends, that you will be a support, a brother or sister to our two new members and be supportive? Thank you. Will you accept that?
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Well, we just want to welcome with a gift, too. Let me grab these gifts. There's a baptismal certificate in here, and there's a little something inside to help you on your spiritual journey.
And we just want to say thank you. Will you be sure and give them a warm welcome today if you get a chance to see them on their way out this morning? So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. And I know that Karsten has a brief testimony that he's going to share with us, and so I'm going to allow you to do that right now.
Okay.
All right.
Great.
You can be seated if you want, or you can stay here. Okay.
Since birth, my son has battled severe health disorders and addictions. Therapy and medication have not helped. The thought arose that perhaps his problems were of a supernatural nature. An exorcism specialist concluded that he was probably harassed by demons. So I began to research the occult. I discovered that the spirit world is very real, and that Satan has been waging cosmic war against God and mankind for millennia. The dark side had been guiding me to books that supported New Age thinking, while God guided me to many impressive books by former apostates and pagans who had come to Christ. One in particular blew me away. It exposed Satan's deceptions, thereby providing me with clarity on many biblical doctrines. Charmed by Darkness by Roger Morneau tells the story of his deliverance from Satan's altar to God's mercy seat. Morneau was being recruited by the dark side. During one of his educational sessions, a high-ranking satanic priest made two stunning statements. Number one, he said that by the observance of the day upon which the master, Satan, has placed the unction of his authority and power, that is Sunday, he receives homage, regardless of whom people think they worship. He said that Sunday worship is a great irritant to the Creator. Then the priest continued, "For centuries, friendly demons have worked diligently to establish and uphold in the religious convictions of all people the belief that man has an immortal soul. The master is so smart that he has deceived the whole world, even in this age of great scientific knowledge and understanding." And someone asked, what about the Adventists? And he said, "Ah, you're right, I forgot the Adventists. They are so few in number that I didn't even think of mentioning. I'm sorry, Adventists cannot be brought under this deception." And this is stunning statement number two. "The fact that Adventists observe the biblical Sabbath of creation and revere the Creator makes it impossible for the spirits to deceive them. They are given very special help and great insight. Under these conditions, they are not ordinary people." Isn't that something? Then I found this printed in the Catholic Mirror in 1893. I didn't read it in 1893, I just found it from 1893. "Most Christians assume that Sunday is the biblically approved day of worship. The Roman Catholic Church protests that it transferred Christian worship from the biblical Sabbath to Sunday, and that to try to argue that the change was made in the Bible is both dishonest and a denial of Catholic authority. If Protestantism wants to base its teachings only on the Bible, it should worship on Saturday. The Adventists are the only body of Christians with the Bible as their teacher who can find no warrant in its pages for the change of the day from the seventh to the first. I was raised Lutheran back when Lutherans were Protestants. All the major Protestant denominations have now signed ecumenical agreements with Rome, and since Rome isn't about to become Protestant, it means that these Protestant organizations will move ever closer to Catholicism. So I decided to move as far as I could from these influences, occultism, paganism, Catholicism, and apostate Protestantism, which means Adventism. Roger Morneau became an Adventist, an ardent Adventist, and his experience led me to investigate Adventism. In Adventism, I found a belief system that feels right to me. It's scriptural, it doesn't compromise, trying to be all things to all people. I was baptized as an infant. Like most infants, I found it bothersome and unnecessary. On the other hand, I now feel that adult baptism by immersion is honest and vital. Through it, I am saying to the world, I am sick of my old life of sin, and I choose to die to it. By his sacrifice on the cross, Christ gives me new life and new hope in him.
Amen.
I belong to him, and you demons, stay away. I thank the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for bringing me here, and I thank you all for being a faithful church.
We welcome you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for sharing that testimony. We praise God for what he has done in Carson and Joseph's lives. And I'm so glad to be able to celebrate this Sabbath with you, and to see our church family growing is wonderful. Today, right now, young people around the world are celebrating what's called Global Youth Day in the Seventh-day Adventist Church. They are worshiping in what I think is one of Jesus' very favorite forms of worship, through service. They're taking Jesus out of the sanctuary walls, taking him to the streets as they go out and love the people around them. It's Global Youth Day, and today I'm very grateful for our church leaders for promoting this day, and I'm especially grateful for our church members, both here at Chapel Oaks and also at New Haven, who are getting involved in the service activities that we're going to be a part of. If you want to see what's happening around the world, use this hashtag on social media, hashtag GYD21, Global Youth Day 2021, to see what's happening. Maybe later in the day, you'll even see some faces that you know show up on social media. There's different groups meeting at New Haven from 1 o'clock to 5 o'clock to go out and feed the homeless, to make cards for those that are living in nursing homes and have felt extra isolated during the pandemic. And there's also the mobile food pantry at New Haven where you can help those who are experiencing food scarcity in these times. And then we're all going to go back at 6 o'clock for a Vespers and some pizza. So it's not too late. If you haven't signed up, you can. How do I make this video go? Is there a way? I need to know this. No? Oh, there it is. All right. See, this is me on my cell phone clicking on links. So you go to the bottom of the blog that I put, the pastor's blog yesterday, and there's a link to where you can sign up. So it's not too late. If you want to sign up, go to our website, click on the pastor's blog. It's also on our Facebook page. You can find the link to sign up. We have t-shirts that you can have if you participate in service today. And I'm excited about this because I believe it's way more important than it may appear at face value. As you'll see today in our sermon entitled The Handoff, sharing Jesus with the next generations isn't just about what we say, it's about how we live. Let's pray together and we'll dive into the message. Let's ask God to prepare our hearts. Lord, I pray that you would speak through me today, that your spirit would move in this place, that you'd open us up, that you'd help us to be receptive, that we would hear something that will encourage us, that we'll hear something that will also move us closer to you and closer to one another and further in our service to reach the world around us. In Jesus' name, amen. Keep your eyes on lane 2. I wonder if we can get any volume with this. It's Team USA in lane 2. Heard a gasp at what you saw. Yes, they are finishing, very last of all, they are finishing though. Couldn't you just feel their pain when that happened? Could you see the frustration? I mean, it happened fast, but just, oh my goodness, what happened? Right? What happened? In a relay race, the most important part is the handoff, right? With good handoffs, a team can actually go way faster than anyone could on their own. The world record, actually, for this kind of relay was set by the previous Team USA at 40.82 seconds to run 400 meters with four people. That's 7 seconds faster than Marita Cox's 400-meter solo record time of 47.6 seconds. And it's over a second faster than Florence Griffith Joyner's 100-meter dash of 10.49 seconds if you multiply it by four. So if you're tracking, they're faster when you have good handoffs. Teams do better than individuals, but only if they make good handoffs. Why? Because once the runner gets up to speed, they can maintain that momentum when they couldn't keep that pace up personally on their own. They just couldn't keep going. But when you have that team, it can keep moving and flowing. For a moment in that specified handoff zone, they run together at the same speed, and the runner from the prior leg looks the baton safely into the hand of the next runner, who takes off with fresh energy and speed. If the handoff goes badly, however, you just saw what happened. Victory is just way out of reach. There's no way. And just like in the video, heads will be hung and shaken in disbelief. So how does that relay race stuff have to do with our scripture reading for today? The psalm says, "Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. No one can imagine his greatness. One generation commends your works, this greatness, to another generation. They tell of your mighty acts. Just as one runner would pass the baton to the next, one generation is supposed to proclaim the good works of God to the next generation." There are many of us who have experienced the life-changing goodness of Jesus, who have seen that he is worthy of that praise, and he's greater than we could ever know or express. We are runners running our leg of the race, fixing our eyes on the prize of Jesus and all he has promised us. But we have another responsibility, and I would say blessing as well. And it's to pay attention to our horizontal relationships as well, to fulfill the commission that Jesus gave us to make him known. We share God by sharing the baton of our experience with God with others. We commend his works to the next generation in this way. We share our experience, our personal experience of his love, of his kindness in both our words and our actions, our daily lives. We hand off his precious promises and share how trusting in those promises of God has made all the difference for us. We share that this truth sets us free. We share that with those who are running the next leg of this race for the kingdom of heaven, for the kingdom of heaven's team. We get to commend and honor and applaud and praise God's works in the Bible, what he's done in history, and what he's done in our own lives. Now, how is sharing our faith typically like passing a baton? Let's break it down a little bit. Here are some ways I thought of. If you think of some ways that sharing our faith with the next generation is like passing a baton, I'd like to hear what you think of as well. But here are some I thought of. First, you have to run your leg of the race. You've got to actually live out your faith. You can't just hold the baton, look at the baton, what a nice baton. Wave it around, sit on it, whatever you want to do with it. You've got to run with it, okay? You got to use it. If you don't, you're going to get bored with that shiny little baton, and you're going to get distracted and start chasing butterflies, right? You're going to toss the baton aside. I doubt the next generation or anyone else will want your faith if you're bored with it and you don't live it out yourself, right? Don't just tell others, oh, this baton makes all the difference. Show them that it changes the way you live your life in a way that they can actually see. So run your leg of the race. Number two, go to them. You've got to go to them. They're not coming back to you on the track. You, in partnership with the Holy Spirit, meet them where they are. You initiate the action because you have the baton of the gospel that they do not have yet. Share your treasure. God goes with you to do this. And number three, you have to match their speed because they're on the move. You got to make sure that they get this baton before they start running as they're looking and racing straight ahead into this exciting life that is ahead of them. Okay? They live in a different world than the one that you grew up in. Yes, they are timeless principles that we have in the scripture, but we need to do our part to make sure they have the baton of faith and run the race of life with it by sharing it in a way that makes sense to them, that makes sense to them. Again, they don't have your history with the church and everything. You got to share it in a way that makes sense to them. Now, there's only a limited area of the track that you can run together. Your window of opportunity will pass quickly. It's a small window of opportunity. And as we know, the pace of this life, the rat race, picks up speed as you go along, as you get older. The younger they receive it and learn to run in God's ways, the way, way better. Number four, you've got to partner with them. You can't just throw the baton in their general direction, right? They're looking the other way. They're off to the races. You've got to go partner with them. You've got to run together. You've got to work together. You've got to trust each other. So in the church, we've got to give real responsibility to them and work alongside them, not just say, oh, go do something important. We're cheering for you. Yay! You work with them. You dialogue with them. You hear what they have to say as very important because it is. We had this incredible conversation in the high school ministry today. Wow, the perspective that they have on church is incredible. Treat them as teammates because that is what they are. And then you cheer them on. When you're working with them, when you're supporting them, that's when you cheer them on. Let them hear you behind them, rooting for them. As they take off, give them your support. And don't expect perfection from them. Let them hear and feel your support as they run their leg of the race and their experience with Jesus. Especially let them hear it when they trip and they fall, because we all do and they all will. So be there. That's when we need to know God's unconditional love through people the most. Of course, there are many ways that this simple little analogy does not compare to the task ahead of us. For starters, many in the next generation may not even recognize that you are on their team or that there's even a race happening at all, right? Which makes it really weird when you're running at them full speed, like, here, take this. It's strange. They may not be looking for your baton, right? Or recognize the gospel as good or relevant news. So we've got to hurry up, build that relationship, connect with them, invest in them as we patiently help them to see why this actually changes everything, everything about our lives. Also, life is a bit more complex than a simple relay race, and there's a lot more people that need to know Jesus than the one person in your lane. Though, it's usually best to give that one person in your lane your attention. Instead of just being overwhelmed with the great need, do what you can do with the people that are in your sphere of influence. Rather than one person giving the baton to one person, the scripture reading from Psalm 145 is talking about one whole generation passing the ways of God to another bigger generation, right? They get bigger and bigger, don't they? One team is recruiting a whole new, bigger, super team to race alongside them. Let's put it this way. We need 100% participation from everyone on Team Jesus because there's a lot of people in the world who don't know Jesus like you do. The population is expanding. The mission field is thus expanding because statistically, we need to keep up with population growth, right? If we could keep up with population growth, that would be great, a great improvement. Even among kids who grow up in the church, when they graduate from high school, statistically, 40 to 50% of them decide not to engage in church anymore. 40 to 50% drift. If the Christian church is losing anywhere near 50% of those who have such a great opportunity to know Jesus through our churches, something is terribly wrong. The handoff is not going well. We must be throwing batons and hoping for the best. Something has to change. Mathematically speaking, if we just reach 50% of our own, and then they reach 50% of the next generation, and they reach 50% of the next, what's happening? You go 50 to 25 to 12.5 and on down, right? The church would eventually cease to exist. Here comes another sad statistic. It'll get better. According to the Pew Research Center, from 2007 to 2014, the adults in the U.S. who identify as Christian fell from 78 to 71%. That 7% seemed that they migrated to the religiously unaffiliated group, which jumped from 16 to 23%. That's a decline of about 1% a year. Each percent is over 3 million people. In that 7 to 8 year period, over 21 million less people identified as Christian. And that was 7 years ago. Imagine how many have left since. How many have you seen leave? We have a crisis in our churches in the United States, and many countries are faring even worse than us. Of course, we know that God has always had and will always have his people, the remnant. The Bible assures us of that, so we have hope in that. Take comfort in it, but don't take comfort in it. Don't stop giving your best, because a remnant of Chapel Oaks is not guaranteed. Many of us know of churches that have closed, of schools that have closed. We don't know, or we don't want this group of friends and families to get anywhere near closing. We want to see it prosper and grow through that 100% participation. I believe that because of our cooperation with the Holy Spirit, he could definitely retain way more than 50%. We want more than 50% of our children, of our youth, of our friends, of our young adults, your kids, your grandkids. Imagine a picture of our youth group. This is not our youth group, but those young, vibrant faces. And then imagine putting an X through 50% of their faces. They're gone. Unless we have something different happen in our church, half will leave. And we can't be okay with that. We can't be okay with that, or even the larger percentage in our community that don't know that the race is even happening. Of course, there's a lot of factors beyond the 1 to 3 hours people spend at church most weekends. There's the influence of friends, of families, of school, the ever-present social media, the entertainment and advertising that hopes to make addicts of us all. But that's why we have to make the most of the time that we do have together. Maybe we need to do some things radically differently. Not just putting on the best possible programs, but to be the best family that we can be. With arms wide open, connecting with genuine warmth in a way that connection outside of this time would be welcomed and wanted. A level of community that's greater than a casual movie or concert or sports event goer could experience at an event or show. This has to be more than a show, right? We're looking for something more than that. Sure, churches can always use better programming. Yes, but I'm not sure anyone was ever saved by a run sheet. Thankfully, there's something even better we can do. Listen to what E.M. Bounds wrote on the topic in Power Through Prayer on page 4. Please hear men and women when I say men in his words. Men are God's method. The church is looking for better methods. God is looking for better men. What the church needs today is not more machinery or better, not new organizations or more and novel methods, but men whom the Holy Ghost can use. men of prayer, men mighty in prayer. The Holy Ghost does not flow through methods, but through men. He does not come on machinery, but on men. He does not anoint plans, but men, men of prayer. Wow, men and women, of course. The Christian church started with one person anointed by God, Jesus, the anointed Messiah. He personally touched his disciples' lives, who passed the baton on to others, who passed it on and on and on until our day, person to person, directly. I believe Jesus is all for strategic and well-made plans and good services, but it is the person-to-person contact that changes people. When one person is on fire, connected to God in prayer and living out their faith, and they come into contact with other people, that fire spreads. It's called a wildfire, right? Relationships are the very best way to connect with people. It's the best thing that the church has to offer. Never forget, the church is people. People are the church. It's not the program. It's not the building. It's not the tech. It's people. It's the people right around you there. Don't tell Mike. Don't tell Diego. But there are thousands of sermons online about just the topic you want to hear about right now. And they might be better speakers than us. Just go click, click, click. And you can get it from the comfort of your home. You don't have to go out. You don't have to see anybody. Just chill in your pajamas. Stay on your phone. The pandemic has made this very clear, hasn't it? We can hear as many excellent messages as we want to. There's more that I want to hear than I have time for. The church can have good musicians, but you could give your offering money to like some really awesome Bose speakers and a music subscription, and you'd have way better music, right? Yeah, absolutely. But as the Beatles sang, you can't buy me love. Relationships are the best of what we offer. But are all of us intentionally offering ourselves in relationships to the next generation? That's what they want. They can be so isolated. I can be so isolated. Just get caught on my phone. It's like, oh, there's people I could actually spend time with, right? I want to tell you about some people who were intentional with me in my life. And it made a big impact in my life when I was about half my age or maybe even younger. First, there was the father of a couple of my buddies from school. They were new to the area, and I could tell that my friend's dad worked really, really hard. But it wasn't until I was much older, just recently, that I realized how hard it was for him. He was in the process of learning how to be a single dad because his marriage went south shortly after the move to my hometown, where he had started graduate school. Because of the separation, he had to pull out of school and find work in a different field altogether. Finances were tight, as he had to start renting a place separate from his former spouse. And so his place where he was renting became the place that my friends and I would hang out after school, and we didn't make their food budget any better. Time was tight, and he was working hard hours. But in the brief moments that he did have, he invested in me alongside his own kids. He'd play basketball with us in the yard. He'd ride dirt bikes with us on the weekends, and he'd volunteer in Sabbath school. He was my first guitar teacher, and he was the first one that gave me experience playing up front in church. He took some of us novice guitar students on the road to play in another church. And even though it was a challenging time for him and his family, he invested in me and instilled in me the importance of a personal relationship with Jesus. I can still hear him saying, it's all about you and Jesus, Jesus and you. He's still a mentor of mine, and I talk to him every month. God has definitely done some amazing things in his life. He is now the youth director for the North American Division. His name is Tracy Wood. Another person that invested in me was this college kid. And to this day, I have a hard time understanding why or how he decided to start pouring into me when I was 15 and he was probably 19 or 20 and one of the coolest people I've ever met to this day. But he let me hang out with his band when they were practicing. He showed me how men can actually show brotherly affection. He included me in his family's game nights. We went to concerts. We jammed on the guitar. We led worship together. We talked about life. We just enjoyed each other's company. When I was running for a student association pastor, he designed my poster. Pick Nick for student association. There's like a picnic, right, on the poster. So, and it worked, thankfully. And once I was in the position, he coached me through it. He had been the SA pastor in the past. He even guest spoke for me on a camp out that we did. And he wasn't a guy that was pursuing pastoral ministry or anything like that. He just loved Jesus and was pursuing him. He was just a guy who had an experience with Jesus, loved him, and commended his works to me and my friends. And he's still incredibly dear to me. His name is Tommy Panago. There was also this couple that hung out in our Sabbath school and would help with food prep, and they'd help with small group discussions. They definitely did not strike me as cool people at the time. And this is really them, and I hope that's not offensive. But they were real, and they were present people. They opened their hearts. They shared their story about how God had taken them and turned their lives around from atheism to Adventism. And it didn't take long until I realized, no, I had it wrong. These people are the definition of cool. They are amazing. I'm so glad that they were willing to share themselves with me and the youth group, even though their kids were too young to be in the youth group at that point. In writing these stories, I'm just so encouraged and blessed to think of all the beautiful people God has put in my path, people that changed my life. And there's so many others I don't have time to mention, men, women, elders, peers, teachers, parents, coaches, and more. I know that this church right here that we're all in today, you people have those kinds of people. I think you are all able to be those kinds of people for someone in our congregation. So I want to take just 30 seconds right now for you to pause and reflect and think of those people who have had that kind of impact on your life, the people who got you here today. You heard me mention mine. I want you to think about the people you saw Jesus in, your church community that invited you in. And I want to invite you in these 30 seconds, as you think of them, just say their name out loud, okay? Don't worry if somebody else is talking. Just say their name out loud, okay? I'm actually going to look at my watch while I do this, and we'll let that moment start now. Nice and loud. Amen. I think the 30 seconds are up and there's still names coming. There's a lot of people, right? I hope you're encouraged by that, and I hope you're encouraged that you would want to be that kind of a person. Like I said, we need 100% participation to make the handoff to the next generation successful. Because as the studies from a wonderful book called Sticky Faith found, no other practice in their research correlated to mature faith in high school and college students as much as two things: involvement in intergenerational worship and relationships. That means having as many youth and young adults as possible involved intentionally in the worship service, not only on Global Youth Sabbath, but regularly. Not just on Pathfinder Sabbath, but regular. They are part of it. And with God's help, just like the rest of us, they can do it. They can bear that load. They can lead spiritually. I first started leading Bible studies when I was about 14 years old. I preached my first little sermonette at 15. I was shocked that my pastor asked me. And I don't think it was very good at all. Honestly, it was not good. But the church just cheered for me and kept giving me opportunities. The Adventist Church started with a bunch of young people, right? If you look at our history, Ellen White received and shared her first vision at 17 years old. What if the church said, oh, she's too young. We're not going to listen to her, right? And nobody gave her a platform. Jesus' disciples were likely in their teens and their 20s when they walked with him. What if Jesus' message had been left with the experienced teachers of the law instead? What would have happened? Young people need to be involved, and we need our young people to be involved for our own sakes, even if they do things differently, and maybe especially because they do things differently. Anyway, I won't get into that conversation I just thought of. Again, no other practice correlates with mature faith as much as involvement in intergenerational worship and relationships. In Deuteronomy 6, Moses made a handoff to the next generation in his farewell speech before he passed away. These are probably the most famous texts in the entire book of Deuteronomy, right up there with the Ten Commandments from the chapter before. Before we even read it, notice that Moses was 120 years old, and he was invested in the next generations right up to the very end. He was one of few people from his generation still alive. There was like Caleb and Joshua, and I think that might be it, right? But he never retired from pouring into them. He did it to the very, very end. I'm talking to you if you have gray hair, all right? Generational ministries are not second rate or second place. They are critical for the survival of this congregation, for this community. I'm grateful, so grateful, for the support that I've seen for the youth in the short time that I've been here. But we're just barely getting started and what we can do. Let's increase our investment and our inclusion of young people in this community. Deuteronomy 6, starting in verse 4, Moses says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. The Lord your God, love the Lord your God, with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up." This is what I see on how to make the handoff successful to more than half a generation. First of all, we are called to love the one and only God with all of our hearts, all of our souls, all of our strengths. And when Jesus referenced this passage, he added that we are to love him with all of our minds, all of our thoughts as well. The word for love here indicates this intimate desire and affection. It's passionate, it's unhindered, it's focused love that is unrivaled in your experience. In the very next line, Moses says that the laws he gave were supposed to be on their hearts. Now, the heart refers to that source of motive in your life, that center of thought. In other words, we are to be completely absorbed and obsessed with God and his ways. From that place of passionate love, they were to impress the ways of God on their children. And I hope you will agree with me that the word children here is not just referring to their own biological children, though parents take note, that relationship you have with them is the most important and predictive in sharing and receiving faith. I think it refers, though, to the entire generation of children. You are to pass this on to the next generation. Moses said to impress the story of God on the next generation by talking about them when relaxing at home or going along their way as they went to sleep and as they started their day. The word for impress in verse 7 is actually more literally translated as sharpen, like sharpening a knife, a blade. To sharpen a blade, you slide it over a sharpening stone over and over and over and over and over again, which is probably why some Bible dictionaries also translate impress as over and over. If the next generation is going to be sharp, they must be exposed to the law and ways of God by people who love him and love them over and over and over and over again. Every Sabbath, every interaction matters. You know, when you hear one negative comment, you pick that out of 1,000 positive comments, and that's what you think about often, right? We need that positive interaction over and over and over. And truth be told, the only way we would talk about anything or any person that much at every waking moment on an ongoing basis would be if that person was our everything, right? Everything. Sometimes we forget that God is all we need. We think we need other things and we get distracted, but God is truly all we need if we let Him be. He will provide. He will show us that He is way more than enough for all of our needs and every desire. If God is truly our everything, if He holds our greatest affections, it will not be a burden to talk about Him or live His way. His commandments are not supposed to be burdensome, right? He's writing that law on our hearts. I have a friend who can talk about Jesus all day, every day, because of his love for Jesus, knowing how much Jesus loves him. He just can go on and on and on, like he can't stop. I believe that God can take us all there, not in an annoying way, in a good way. This friend talks about it in a good way. I love it. When we increasingly love God like that, we'll be able to say confidently with Paul, "Follow me as I follow Christ." That seems like a high standard. Whoa, follow the way I follow Christ, like I'm your example. That's a gutsy statement. But I think God can take us there when we love Him so much. Come experience what I'm experiencing with Him. Now, we may never stop making mistakes this side of eternity, but the youth would rather we didn't pretend we were perfect anyway, right? They just need people to be real with them, to even show what it's like, "Oh, I made a mistake. Let's navigate this thing with Jesus. Let's find healing in Jesus. Let's find restoration in Jesus." That's what we all need, that unconditional love. And like Russell in the movie Up, you'd be surprised how much love, support, and purpose the next generation will give you in return. Now, if you take this sermon, this message seriously, it will interfere with your life. As I'm asking you to give more of your time, more of your energy, more of your priority, and more of your money to the young. But I hope you can see that it's part of the counterintuitive wisdom and gospel of God. That as you give generously here, you will be more filled with that love of God that makes you His everything, the God who makes you His everything. Just as Jesus endured the cross, despising its shame, for the joy set before Him, the joy of having you, His everything. That's what God wants you to feel for Him and for the young people in this church. Remember those runners, the ones who dropped the baton? Well, you may not have noticed this. The screen is kind of small on the screen. But one of the other teams actually interfered with their handoff, which resulted in them getting a second chance to run that race. Let's see how it went. Yeah, you can see the replay here now. She got tripped. She threw the baton. And they're devastated. Can hardly see her feet. Within a second of the world record. they qualify. And they qualified, I think, with the very fastest time of all. After it looked like they had lost everything, they got a second chance, and they didn't waste it. Every week, you get to show up here and practice loving one another with Jesus' love that he's ready to pour out on each one of us and into our hearts every day. Don't worry about perfection. Just keep showing up, not only for a program here, as important as they may be, but for a relationship. I believe the next generation will receive that handoff from you and commend the faith to the next. I want to close by sharing some ideas for next steps. Number one, don't just come to church for yourself. Come both to be blessed and to be a blessing. Greet, and I believe you'll get the greatest blessing by seeking to bless others. Greet the people around you every Sabbath. Get to know each other's names, even if you're embarrassed that you forgot the name because you heard it before. Ask about one another's lives with genuine interest and check in the next time you see them. You'll have an opportunity to practice these very skills at the end of this service today. And be sure that you receive the love of those who are reaching out to you as well. Number two, consistently invest in young people in your life, whether they are in or out of the church. One of the best things you can do is invest in them, is to provide an empathetic ear. Try to remember what it was like to live in their shoes, even if they're a couple sizes smaller or bigger. Teenage boys get some pretty big feet. Number three, adopt at least one younger person than you to pray for and minister to as God makes the way. If you're up to it, like if you're a youth leader, adopt four or five, even better. If you don't know how to make that initial connection, we have some amazing children's and youth ministry leaders here. We've got Sam and Eric and Luke and Ray and Brian and Dawn and Melissa and Esther and Heidi and Lauren and Robin and many more who can help with those connections. There are avenues to get connected. Number four, get involved in our generational ministries on some level and stay connected with the kids you meet there. Whether you're making food or you're teaching or doing music or buying stuff, get invested in some level in our generational ministries. Number five, pray that God will deepen your love and your passion for him and your love and passion for the next generation. You need a baton to pass and the perseverance to make that handoff. Also pray he will move those around you to action as well, that more laborers will be sent into the abundant harvest that there is. They are around. They are there to be reached. Finally, put aside the mental obstacles, the doubts. Whether you're 7 or you're 97, now is a great time to start investing in those who are younger than you. If you're 97, you have lots of options. Don't think that your voice doesn't matter. Don't listen to the voices that say you're not blank enough, young enough, cool enough, comfortable enough, exciting enough, wealthy enough, whatever. I gotta tell you, I get uncomfortable with the youth as well. I do. Sometimes I think they're intimidating. I do. Yeah, believe it or not. Yep, that first Sabbath I was here, or that first Wednesday night, I was nervous. What's it going to be like? Believe me, when I left my previous church, Azure Hills, I heard stories from some kids who said that in the beginning, they did not like me. But when we were saying goodbye, we're both in tears. Just keep showing up. I was told by one of the parents that I was a good youth pastor because I kept reaching out even when the kids put up walls. On purpose, they put up walls. Just keep showing up. Just keep loving. There are young people in your life that need you for things that youth pastors can't do. Keep your eyes on the prize of Jesus and the runners who will take the next leg of the race will get our team the victory that we're looking for. It will mean the world and even eternity for the next generation. Let's make the handoff. Let's pass the baton. We're going to sing a closing chorus now, and then we'll read a poem and we'll end with a prayer. The book of Psalms declares that we commend his words to those who follow close behind us as the gospel we disclose. So run your leg and go to them, then match their speed as one, and partner with them side by side while cheering as they run. We can't accept that half our youth will drift despite our plea, So keep them close, invest their hearts, and be their family. All our lives you have been faithful as we run this marathon, passing the baton of faith to those who carry on. Let us pray. God, you have been faithful. You have been love. Transform us to live in your way, to enjoy it, to want it, to delight in it in a way that it's easy to give it away, easy to share. Thank you that we don't do this work alone, that your Holy Spirit fills us, goes before us, flows through us. We do not do this alone. May we be encouraged, God, by those who have gone before us, by those who have reached us, and may we be Jesus to others as they were Jesus to us. We ask and pray all these things in his glorious name. Amen. Just a couple announcements. If you want to be involved in those service projects this afternoon, you can still sign up. You can still come over to New Haven and be a part of it. We'd love to have you there. And I invite you to take a moment. You thought of all those names of people that touched your life. Please take a moment to share those stories with your church family around you. Ask somebody, hey, who touched you? Ask them their story. And I also want to invite you, I believe there are supplies to make cards for those in nursing homes at the table in the back. If you are going to be involved in the service this afternoon, there are shirts back there for you as well, sizes small, medium, and large. I've got about 30 of them. I want to get rid of all of them, so please get involved in some kind of service. Even if it's not one of the three I've announced, if it's NC4Y, take one. You certainly deserve it. And be sure to warmly welcome Joseph and Karsten as you see them today. Thank you all for being here. Have a wonderful, wonderful Sabbath. Thank you.